eSportBets.com – уникальное место для настоящего геймера. Только здесь возможны ставки на киберспортивные события. Ты знаешь толк в самых популярных играх и готов рисковать? Смотри регулярные трансляции и зарабатывай реальные деньги. eSportBets.com – живой азарт и холодный расчет.
Okay, we actually managed to have a little bit of time before we went ready, which is great news, but now we are finally getting into it. It's going to be LDLC versus Fnatic in a best of one game for the SLTV Starseries Season 10. So welcome to the show and welcome to Room on Fire. So glad you guys want to help us out and tune in and enjoy the show. But now we're going to switch it to the actual game. Semla and Vendetta, how are you guys doing? You're looking forward to this match, I'm sure.
Absolutely. It's always exciting to see, I guess, somewhat new teams play up against top competition. And even though it's been a while since the Fnatic lineup was announced, it's still fairly fresh. And I really do like a lot of those players on that team. So I'm excited to see how they gel. And you know, obviously, you can kind of gauge somewhat how their form is prior to the upcoming big events. So that's going to be cool because I think that, if I'm not mistaken, they're going to Gfinity at the end of July.
Yes, they will be there.
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, obviously they're not going to be slouching here. They're in full practice mode, and I'm excited to see how good they can get in a short amount of time.
I mean, LDLC, they already finished off once on this map against Hellraisers, and they lost that game. And part of the reason why they lost, we thought, was because some of their timing, some of their rotation times were a little bit off, and we were wondering if that was just, you know, because the Frenchmen have been not playing for quite a while. They've had a bit of a break, and now they're back again. So I'm wondering if one game is going to be enough for them to change that around, because they're going to need to playing against Fnatic.
Yeah, it's the same scenario, or it would end up being the same scenario as versus Hellraisers, I think, because Fnatic and Hellraisers are both excellent teams who will punish you if you make mistakes. And especially with a good in-game leader like Pronax, is really solid with his mid-run calls, so he's going to sniff that out.
That's the thing, right? But I still feel like there's going to be this. There has to be some kind of edge into going into this for LDLC, because right now they don't really know what to expect from Fnatic, I feel. Like, they're going to be going into it just thinking, like, okay, well, you know, two new players on a lineup, that's quite a bit. What is going to be happening here on this team? And already we have a different change here.
I mean, hell.
A B stack right off the bat for Fnatic.
I was going to say, no one was expecting this from Fnatic. No, don't care if you're LDLC or anyone else. This is definitely a very cool setup. I think we've seen it maybe once before, but it is a huge risk to take. Pronax trying to pretend to be really aggressive, right? He was down the middle showing himself. Now he's up in apartment showing, I'm right here. Just don't even bother coming to the A-bomb site. It's really dangerous over here. And he's looking for one more pick. But Maniac's going to take the fight with him. And Pronax is very low on health. Apex could just pick him off, and that will leave the A-bomb site completely open. And there it is. Now
they
the question is, look at
Fnatic. This is going to have to be one hell of a retake. I think Fnatic should have started rotating the second Pronax gets down to low HP. That's someone needs to rotate at that point. It's still a three-man second B. It's still pretty decent, so you can afford to put one guy towards a bomb site to help Pronax out. And now this is going to be so tough. They have no nades. They have a decoy, that's it.
And they're walking into the middle where there's a pretty good crossfire. Happy gonna pick up two of those kills, and then it's down to JW and Flusher getting some good headshots, and JW with a sick double kill leaves it down to a one-on-one. Flusher tries the fake, he's gonna go really aggressively, and Happy just trying to buy time, and that's all he has to do this round. I don't even think he can win it anymore. Flusher goes down, and it's Happy with a quad kill, but obviously even if Flusher had got that kill on Happy, it would have made no difference. So LDLC, I mean, they actually only barely won that round, which makes you wonder, then, as you said, if they had rotated initially, what would have happened?
Yeah, if they could have denied the bomb plant or just delayed it for a tiny bit, that could have been the difference. But yeah, they opted not to. I guess they felt pretty strongly about their setup and had a pretty good idea of what LDLC wanted to do. And for a second there, it looked like LDLC wanted to go with three people towards that B bomb site. So I think it was just unfortunate that Pronix got caught out.
I think that was it. It was mainly just how patient... JW has a flip knife, by the way. But it was mainly just how patient LDLC were, because you saw Kaylee dancing at the bottom of mid with that bomb for ages. Like, they were really just trying to feel out where Fnatic were holding. And the man up in apartments for LDLC, I forget which one it was, he was just so busy scouting everything out, not seeing any movement at all, not being contested after that first peek with Pronax in the apartments, that I think LDLC, you know, they just put two and two together, made the right call.
Some good damage put out early on here. Apex down to 60, but if you'll notice, there's no body armor at all on Fnatic, so they're doing it with you know, the pistols they bought and one grenade here, but that's about it. So actually, considering the damage they've done right now, I kind of wish they had body armor, because I feel like maybe this could be a round where they could actually change something.
Let's see exactly how things are going to go here.
Oh, look at Olafmeister. Just look. I've seen this position before, only once, and that was in a video on Reddit. Now see how it's going to play out. Crims goes down, and that's what they want here. Flusher gets a kill, then runs out, and now all they need to do is convince him that Olafmeister is not in this position. If only he had a defuse kit. I wish he had a defuse kit now. Right now. He's actually just going to jump down, gets the one kill, and then goes down. I think the other option would have been even better, but Happy's still alone here. One on three. He takes the one, and now he's waiting at the back. They know exactly where he is. He's down to 34. He's going to have to do really well here. They're coming from every angle, and Pronax, actually JW, will take him down, and Fnatic still win the round. And, well, that position, it definitely paid off.
Cheeky position, and yeah, he probably could have gotten one more, but still did the job. I was a cheeky boy from Fnatic. And the V-Stack kind of worked that time. Didn't really work in the pistol round, definitely worked in the eco round.
And what more is that? Was that a Kevlar buy? I don't think so.
No, it wasn't.
I think Fnatic just went in. They went in straight pistols. So this goes a long way towards them having so much money in this third round. I mean, look at it. They're full nades, full rifles, pretty much everything. The whole kit and caboodle. Like, that's a great play from Fnatic for that to actually work out. A lot of that has to do with Flusha as well, I think. Just the shot that he got falling back through the smoke into CT where he was just spraying with the 5-7 and managed to pick up a kill. That sort of kill is invaluable. That's really going to slow LDLC down.
Yeah, and apparently another DDoS thing coming out. And
no way.
It's fun that it's LDLC complaining about DDoSing because, you know, that's happened to you guys in the past a little bit. But fair enough, it is really frustrating, and we obviously just had one match where we had nothing but DDoSing going on. Unfortunately, I can't even bring up the scoreboard because mine is somehow bugged out, so I'll try and see if I can fix that eventually, but I don't want to do it right now. So we're just waiting, seeing what's going on. Again, thank you for joining us here. We are sorry about all these weird delays, especially in a match that's turning out already to be quite interesting.
Yeah, maybe just internet. I think now it's not like, it's like a cry wolf? No. Could be crying wolf, but like now I think it's like any little hiccup in the internet, you just start having a cold sweat. You're like, no, how did they find me? You're like, no, how did they do it? So maybe JW knows just a little bump in the road here, and he'll be able to get things sorted.
Hopefully.
Crossing fingers here.
Okay. Well, I mean, for how we want these games to be going here.
Yeah. But, I mean, this is pretty nice. Apparently JW knows how to deal with it, so he's like, yeah, I'm just going to change my IP.
Apex trying to appeal to, you know, it's an emotional appeal from Apex. Stop it, please. Yours.
With the sad face.
Yeah, that's how you solve this issue. There's no doubt.
Yeah. You'll reach to their emotions.
Exactly. That's how it works. Okay, well, again, to just reiterate and remind all of you, if you want to support us, then it's pretty easy. All you have to do is click the follow button on the channel. If you really want to support us, you can also obviously subscribe, and thanks to those of you who already have. You can also go and follow us on Twitter, which is at VendettaGo. It's at OnFireSemler and OnFireAnders on Twitter. So do that, and we'll definitely appreciate it. And go, you know, whatever you do, definitely on Wednesday, you guys have to tune in. It's the first time. The first time we're going to be doing our own tournament with four great teams playing for €1,000. King.de. So we really appreciate it that we get the opportunity to do all of this, and you guys gotta help us out with that. In the meantime, though, we were just talking about this in the break a little bit. Have you guys seen the new team with Muddy, Schneider, Pyth, Twist, and Sentries? That is actually quite a powerful aiming team.
Sentries!
Yeah.
I'm glad to see him back on a team finally after Copenhagen Games. Been waiting for that. I was hoping he wouldn't just kind of like fade out, because that Sentries, you know, he decided to go full-time with CS as well just a bit before that. And so, you know, really just glad that he was actually able to find a really strong team, actually. I mean, you've got a lot of talent on here. Schneider's here. Maudie is here.
Everyone is a strong link in that team. It's pretty ridiculous, actually.
You got to wonder if Khan is out there somewhere thinking, why didn't I think about getting Maudie back?
Because how many times has he had Maudie back on his team now?
Would have been the fourth time, wouldn't it? I don't think he would live through the harassment from Lurpus and Thorin if that happened.
No, but that's the main reason why I wish it wouldn't happen. It'd be so funny. Oh, man.
In any case, we're only joking. Yeah, it's fun to see them creating a team. It's been a while since we've seen Python in a proper team. He's been standing in for several teams here and there and going to events with mixed teams and whatnot. So for him to have a stable team, that's pretty cool. Sentries as well, as you guys mentioned. Starting to get a bit worried that he was actually contemplating quitting CS because he has been playing a lot of Dota as of late. Not that much CS, but yeah, it's good to see him back. I think this could be a really good team. I'm excited to see how this pans out for them.
Yeah, I am too. I think it could be very cool. And I think everyone at this point is really happy to see Schneider land on his feet as well and, you know, not quit the game entirely, but actually play on. So well played, Schneider, for keeping that up.
Yeah.
Exactly. Did they say anything about their next upcoming event or, like, what their goals were in terms of they're going to be at DreamHack Winter first, or are they going to go anywhere in the meantime?
For this team, I mean, they're playing with Flipside, so they should... they should be able to go to an event if the opportunity presents itself.
Hopefully they will, but I can't really think of an event that's not
Assembly.
Invite, is it?
Assembly at the end of the month? Is that invite only?
I think I saw Lurpus tweeting about that there was one invite spot left open.
You know what? You're right.
A couple of days
that.
Ago. So who knows? What? Maybe there's a connection here. But then again, it seems like this is a fairly... it's a really fresh team. I don't think they've played together that much at all. So if they want to take the time to go to Finland in 2 weeks, who knows? Maybe.
I'm guessing in that team it's going to be Maudie doing the calling then.
Looking at it?
Yeah, wouldn't be surprised.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah, should be.
I actually hope we get to see Twist playing the same role he had in back in Bugget in earlier editions of Lemon Dogs. Because I think that's when he was at his absolute best. Not that he's gotten any worse, but you know that's where he was in his most dominant position, I guess. And I would really like to see him go back to that, where he was kind of a do-it-all kind of guy and was just like fearlessly running into bomb sites first and killing everyone.
That is the kind of play we like, don't we?
Oh, yeah. Man mode CS is really fun to watch when it works. It's not that great when it doesn't work because you kind of look like a dumbass who just left your team. But when it works, and Twist made it work most of the time, it's really fun to watch.
Yeah, I think Twist is arguably one of the biggest talents in Sweden. So, you know, he's just suffering from what a lot of other people are suffering from, which is that whole situation where you can't really find like a stable team that will actually play with you for more than just a, you know, 3 months.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'm not even pointing any fingers. You know, the Danish scene is very much like that.
You don't say.
Indeed.
It's good to see another potential top tier team coming into the fold here for Sweden. Like, there's so much raw talent in Sweden.
Like,
it's
they
crazy.
Didn't have enough already.
Right? It's like, okay, let's get another team going, right? Okay. To me, that's just great because a player like Schneider, the last thing I want to see is Schneider, you know, get it in his head that he should be retiring. He is way too good.
Yeah, I agree.
To not be on a team. So hopefully, you know, he'll get some good opportunities to display.
Oh, can you imagine the first game that F3 team plays versus Fnatic?
Oh, yeah.
With all the history? Because you've got obviously Maudie, who's been a recurring star, I guess, had a recurring role in Fnatic. Schneider, obviously, with how things ended in that team. Sentries is just really good friends with all of the Fnatic players as well.
Yeah, I was going to say he played with them when they were in Epsilon, when they played DreamHack Summer 2013 and finished second for both the tournaments then.
Yeah,
you're right. So
there's a lot of history and a lot of stories that you could pull out from that.
You know who so they should? You know should really they should exciting. Have standing in? They should have Devil Walk standing in.
Yeah.
Just you know, Coach
Fnatic. Who's gonna have to bow out for that game though?
I don't know. Just if they're missing someone, you know, have Devil Walk step it up. All right. Well, Devil Walk's actually in the chat now, so thank you, Devil Walk, for tuning in. And he's telling us it's going to be just a second. So hopefully, obviously, Devil Walk, you know, now fulfilling a coaching role with Fnatic, which, yeah, I can actually see working out pretty well. I'm excited.
It's that whole concept of the sixth man, right?
Yeah.
The thing is, who's better placed than Devil Walk to provide insight for the team, because he knows everybody on the team so damn well. He knows, you know, the tactics, what Pronax has in mind, and being able to stand behind them and really study their game live while it's going on, not being in the game, that could make a big difference. So,
does that mean Karn is not coming to events anymore?
I'm sure.
Question, actually. Because then what would that mean? It was like you'd have Devil Walk and Karn standing behind, and then they start talking over each other, and the players, they don't know who to listen to anymore, and then it just all devolves into confusion and madness.
Fnatic goes out in the group stage.
No, never again. Never again. Okay, look, guys, we have resumed the game again. We're sorry about all these delays, but it is out of our control. We're just here talking about whatever comes up. Now, JW, look how aggressive he is all the way down here. LDLC obviously won the pistol round, but then lost the second round after a pretty cool boost from Olofmeister over at the B-bomb side and a bunch of other shots coming out from Fnatic. So it wasn't just Olofmeister, but that obviously caused a lot of panic on the French side.
So let's see exactly how things shake up here now, because we do know that this is a pretty big pistol armor buy here for LDLC. I mean, pistols, full nades, head armor, like they've invested in this round. So they can do some damage. Fnatic cannot take this lightly at all. Smoke goes down on B though, so now at the minute mark on top of it, that's not going to leave a whole lot of time for LDLC to act if they do decide to go for B.
No, definitely not. And there's one on Crims as well. So, you know, just about 45 seconds here. The next one's going to go up. And at point, well, as you said, Samro, if they try and push through, and they will just push through here. Flashes in. Crims actually is very exposed, and he's still going to get the first kill. Keeps spraying, just holding it down, and takes down Uzi as well. Now, they're going to get wrapped around, but Olofmeister's able to take care of it. The bomb, I think, will go down, but that's probably all that LDLC are going to get this round. A complete cleanup from Crims and Olofmeister, the two newcomers to the team. They do a fine job hanging on.
Yeah, very cool to see that they're actually holding B-Site together as well, Crims and Olofmeister. I mean, if anybody on the team is going to have the experience to be able to work together, you've got the three former Fnatic members sitting on A-Site, with Pronax kind of floating around in the middle, and then you got Crims and Olofmeister holding B, and doing a pretty damn good job of it so far. So, that's one thing that was really curious to me, or that, not curious, but interesting, is how Fnatic were going to change who holds where, and how they were going to change their CC side on Inferno, because we know that they've been really scratching their heads about it for quite some time.
Yeah, and I think it was, that's a shot from Crims, but yeah, I think it was Pronax and Devil Walk who played B, mainly for Fnatic earlier, prior to the change, so yeah. I guess it makes sense that either Olofmeister or Krems would have hopped in towards the B side, but it's just, Pronax have ventured towards the A-bomb side instead.
Yeah, Pronax playing Arch, I think, now.
I'm just looking at Happy right now and his Sonoff shotgun. That's really the only thing that worries me.
Hey, that goes through walls now, man. Careful.
Yeah, but he doesn't use it. He just rushes out, picks up an AK instead. So he just bought the shotgun for show, I guess. Now they're going to be wrapping up behind them, and this is working out pretty well for Fnatic. No idea what's happening as LDLC. And Happy going to show us a pretty cool pose, but he dies anyway, so it's not really worth that much. 3-1, and we're moving into the fifth round, where JW is going to be picking up an AWP now. I had a discussion earlier today with Devil Walk about JW and this AWP, and I used exactly Inferno as my example to say that sometimes JW hits some amazing shots, but when he fails, that's where Fnatic in the past at least have started to really struggle. Let's see if that's changed with the addition of these new players. There's already the pickoff, so JW does exactly what he's supposed to do in that position.
Yeah, I think the best thing about that entire sequence is the fact that he backed off.
Because
because it's like you said, normally we'd see JW pull up some crazy stuff with that off, especially on Inferno. But when he gets rolling, he gets really rolling. So he just steams on forward until someone stops him. And that has put Fnatic in a bit of an awkward situation more than once. So it's good to see him just get that entry frag, get the advantage, back off, and get into a new position.
I think that's it. It's also where he decides to take the AWP at the very beginning of the game. That's become a little bit predictable. So him trying to keep the reins on and play it a bit more passive, that's really interesting. We have to see where he takes it in the rounds to come. Like that's gonna be it.
Yeah, I think he's already been like on a wild journey down to like aggressively in the CT apps. So yeah, he's definitely out and about.
Oh, nice shot there by Crims, and Uzi will get one, but then get flashed out by Olafmeister. So 4-1 the score right now between Fnatic and LDLC.
Yeah, Olafmeister taking a page out of Existence book right there. This is a flashbang that Existence from Titan, especially when they were playing his very games, used to do a lot. It's right into the wall. I mean, it's not exclusive to him, but it's something that we definitely sort of recognize him by. So that's pretty cool. It worked just fine. Fnatic are 4-1, and we're moving into the sixth round.
Yep, okay, JW's going into apartments now. This is his go-to kind of play right now with the AWP. But he doesn't decide to cross. Instead, he's going to back off to short. So, yeah, JW, once again, it seems like Fnatic, they go for like the peak at the beginning to get that information and then decide to back off and just hold the angles.
Showing some restraint.
I'll be damned. But they have to be worried about the CZs. I think that's it. Like, they have to be worried about getting up close because they could just get trained down, especially when you've got an AWP. Only one shot.
Oh, yeah, and he does take a shot to the face. I think Flusher could have gone down then. He was very exposed, misses another one here, but the pistol, actually Pronax with the AK, is going to take care of everything. And finally, JW goes down. Pronax could fall as well, but Kaylee, oh, those are some really sick pistol shots. Look at how much damage he did, just single-handedly. But it's not enough for them to win the round, and they still get to save the AWP, so Fnatic's still off to a very fine start.
Yeah, Fnatic are looking really strong. Not that LDLC have had too many buy rounds up till this point, but Fnatic have been handling them really well. I think the closest they've gotten buying their pistol was actually that eco round right there.
Yeah.
So yeah, that tells a bit of a tale actually of how well Fnatic are playing right now.
Happy boosted to try and look over the smoke, but they're just shooting through and they are gonna come out on top. This is a trick that Fnatic have learned. It feels to me like that trick with boosting over the smoke down on Banana. It works so well as long as people don't know you're doing it. And we just catch JW picking off a kill on Apex with a pretty cool flick. Pronax inside the bedroom. Actually just... Yeah, he can't hear him. Maniac had no idea where that shot was coming from because of the silencer. And now the round is pretty much over. It's just Kaylee left in a 1-on-4. And this Fnatic team is actually looking pretty terrifying right now.
Holy hell, JW is looking terrifying. Those were two good shots right there. The first one, very nice, but the second one where he comes through Boiler, still manages to kill the guy coming out of apartments. That was big. But now Kaylee, he kills one man rotating over from B, but decides to slow it down and head back over towards A. He's about to run into Pronax, gets him too. Kaylee right now really coming up big, and now JW has to worry about getting flanked.
Yeah, still 30 seconds left. This can be done by the Frenchman. It would be a pretty incredible ace if he could win this from... A 1-on-4, basically. Now moving in, looking for JW, who's hiding behind there. 24 seconds, and JW goes for the kill, and will get it as well. But the really cool thing about what he did as well is that he waited long enough for Olafmeister to also get there. So even if Kaylee got that kill, he would have had to put down the bomb, and then Olafmeister would have got an easy kill. So it's all pretty good here for Fnatic.
Yeah, so far so good, definitely, for the Swedish team. And it's nice to see that they're gelling so quickly. For not having been together for that long. That's a good sign for them going into Gfinity.
Oh, grenades, look at this. They're waiting for it. Maniac might be about to catch one. Is he gonna? Yeah, it does some damage. Not as much as it could. They wait a little bit too long. But now they smoke off and LDLC are gonna be charging through. Crims goes down as well. And finally, a great opening here. And it's Uzi, Kaylee, and Apex. They take one each. And finally, it's gonna be another round for LDLC.
That was very nice work there by LDLC as well. Just that kind of play from Fnatic is very cool, but at the same time, you are kind of telegraphing exactly where your guys are on the B site, right? So LDLC are like, sweet, two nades down the B site, down Banana. Okay, well, we know that we have to look towards B site right now.
Yeah, and you got a little bit of patience from LDLC as well, because obviously the Fnatic players have given away their position by doing a double nade like that. But the fact that LDLC doesn't go ham and just run at the bomb site and basically alert every Fnatic member that they're coming towards B. That was probably the smartest thing they did, because they kept on walking until they were like halfway inside the smoke that was just put down by Fnatic, and it caught both Fnatic members on that B bomb site off guard completely, and all of a sudden there's a free bomb site and no man down.
That was pretty much what happened. I mean, the thing is, the problem is, it's kind of hard to repeat what they just did because it did rely a little bit on Fnatic having, you know, that exact play.
Yeah. Yeah, they got timed out pretty hard.
Yeah, so how do you... I mean, that's the problem. Is like, if you win and you can repeat that kind of victory, things are looking pretty good, but I guess maybe timing is just the key here. Apex going to walk in right as Pronox has a grenade out and open it up, and we're in another 4-on-5 here with LDLC opening up, so you know, that's a good adjustment here for LDLC. If they can keep playing like this and getting those early pickoffs, then they're going to be doing a lot better.
That's the really important part at this point, getting that entry frag for them, especially when they are not necessarily, well, they are somewhat limited on nades as well, but JW right now, he's in a bit of a tight spot. He's about to get wrapped around. There's three guys building up in apartments going towards balcony, and JW, he's looking towards boiler room. He's expecting somebody to come through here, and he could get shot in the back.
He actually managed to run away. That smoke really helped him out. They couldn't see him now. He's way too close for an AWP. He's going to take the one kill, goes for the no scope. They're just not killing each other, and JW somehow is still alive. How is he not dead? Finally, he goes down, and LDLC will win the round. I think Maniac picked up a triple kill, but I have no idea how he lived that long. 50 bullets. All right, and a quick shout out to Freiburg, who's spamming our chat. Thank you very much, Adam. We do love you.
Freiburg is one with the Twitch chat.
Oh, yeah.
Dude, Freiburg is like the head troll, man. We call him the master of the banana, but he's all about the master of the chat. Too. Yeah. He knows.
Oh, grenades down banana, but it's Happy coming out with the kill. And Crims will take one swiftly and returns a quick exchange. And I guess Fnatic did come out a little bit on top, but now they just keep trading. And the more this happens, the more it's going to be LDLC's favor.
Agreed. Even though JW managed to get the flank on somebody and pick up a kill with that AWP, that was a great shot on Pronax through the car. But now the smoke has been put down, so that's going to slow LDLC down somewhat. We have to see if they're going to work their way back up A, as they are heading back up mid with that bomb.
Yeah, and if they walk up here, I mean, JW, he can certainly take one, but he still has a ton of grenades to try and get himself out of this corner. So I think this is going to be all JW. Oh, the smoke. They saved one LDLC, and they see it coming. Very nicely done. And now he's just wondering here, do I leave or do I just call for some backup? Flusher is coming in, but by the time they get here, I think the bomb might actually be down.
Does he make any noise as well? Well, looks like he decides to use that CZ. Whole clip practically goes through, but it is going to be... What? That didn't hit JW! I thought he had a shot there, and he just barely misses it. Now we're into a 2-on-2.
What's really shocking is they brought the bomb up into graveyard, so now there's no plant. Maniac made a big mistake that round. I have no idea why. They might still be able to fight it out. Yeah, JW goes down, so it's unhappy to pick up a triple kill and finish the round, but I understand they wanted to check the bomb site, but I have no idea why you would put the guy with the bomb on that type of duty. Why not let the guys who have just rifles do it?
Yeah, I think that was just a slip of communication there from LDLC. Luckily for them, though, it worked out and then cost them the round, but it very easily could.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Bit of a lucky draw from the Frenchman.
But things are looking up. 6-4 is what we are currently at. And some great grenades down the middle from Fnatic doing good amount of damage. JW this time without an AWP. So that says something about Fnatic's economic state. Even though they did have a pretty good lead early on, now it's catching up to them.
Yeah, it's really starting to fade away here. This is one of those rounds where they're in good danger of losing now at this point. Of having to go on eco, losing all that money. LDLC, however, have actually developed quite a bit of a bank. I mean, Happy's sitting on close to 10k after buying. That's actually a silly amount of money right now on the T side of Inferno. So things are looking up for the Frenchman here at this point. The pressure's on Fnatic to shut them down this round.
And LDLC are actually going for an NIP play here, just having Maniac over by the boiler room, and everyone else is going to be pushing the B bomb side. Very classic Inferno play coming out at the moment. All of Meister inside looking for a kill. A lot of flashbangs raining in, and all Maniac has to do is just stay alive and backstab them as they go for the B-bomb site here.
Oh, there's one in pull. There's actually two in pull now. It's going to come down to Crims. Crims needs to stay alive on this site. Maniac has caught JW rotating. That's not going to help things here for Fnatic. But Flusha is now here to support Crims. Lend him a hand. He needs to find this one, and he does. Jumps up and gets the kill, and Crims gets Happy in the meantime.
So, Maniac did his job just fine, but everyone else did not. That's what it seemed like to me, Vendetta, in that round.
I think the biggest issue was the fact that they went for B bomb site, and they didn't clear out new boxes, which is crazy to me. I don't really know how you can actually go, actually try to plant the bomb without having cleared out the site. And obviously, Kronos did a ton of work from that position. Got some help from Flush as well, and those two combined for, I think, 4 kills that round?
Yeah.
If I'm not mistaken?
Yeah.
Yeah, so that was it. Just Krems being patient, holding out from the new boxes. Flush of denying the plant as well obviously helped quite a bit. Yeah, I think LDLC should have opted or sent more people towards clearing out the site instead of running in towards spawn.
Wow.
You've got to be kidding me, Krims. That was right through the smoke. And he made it look like he deliberately just decided, okay, it's time for a headshot.
He jumped up. He was jumping there using the roof edge to keep him from jumping too high. That was sick. Krims is top fragging right now on the map, by the way, just to point that out. So, I mean, one of those guys we're really looking to see results from, just because, you know, he's new to the roster with Olafmeister. Krims definitely delivering in this match.
And it's JW in the middle, in fact, getting another kill. That makes it a triple. The first two were great headshots, and one of them was up in the apartments. That leaves Happy alone. And probably not all that happy at the moment. They're about to be 8-4, and he's just completely boxed in here. Krims will add another one to his scoreline. And, well, I actually can't see it until the round switches it. But you're right, Krims has 15 kills. And the closest to him right now is 12 on JW. Then on the other team, it's 11 for Happy. But that's what it's at right now. Fnatic doubling the round score of LDLC.
That's what you're wondering about, right? I think JW right now, he's getting kind of miffed. He's like, I can't let this stand. I need to be at the top of the scoreboard. He's going to go hunting. He's going to be even more aggressive.
They've actually opted to go for 3 people towards the B bomb site this round. And well, the last time they stacked, they stacked the B bomb site twice, and it had mixed results. And the pistol, it didn't really work out at all. And the following eco, it worked out pretty nicely.
JW realized that Krims is playing B, so that's where the frags have got to be happening. So he decided, I'm going B too.
Yeah.
Oh, well, he did eventually fall back, so now it's just going to be back to basics, basically, for Fnatic. It looks like LDLC are going to be charging through here, but there are a lot of people waiting on the other side, and they have automatic rifles. And Apex, well, he has just the pistol, and he's the only one left as well, is going to be going down after it does get a headshot in Olafmeister, but that's actually 4 kills for Krims, extending his lead even further and bringing us to the 14th round. 9-4. I mean, I was pretty happy for LDLC at some point in this match, but right now, I'm wondering if they're going to stay at 4 rounds.
Yeah, well, the couple of rounds they got in succession was due to, I guess, a bit of a lucky circumstance. For instance, yeah. they got the entry frag onto Kronex the second he pulls up a nade. They surprised Olafmeister and Krims at the B-bomb site. You know, where stars are aligning for the Frenchman. And otherwise, they haven't had that much to show, really. Fnatic have been doing a good job of shutting them down, but we'll see what happens.
This time, they have a lot more speed, and that seems to work out really well. So maybe that is the key to defeating Fnatic at this point, simply putting on so much pressure that they never get into a position where they can get those really good pickoffs, because they've been great at doing that. Olafmeister is going to walk up and take down Happy, and that actually boxes the rest of the terrorist team inside the A bomb side. Yeah, they have the bomb down, but now they're going to have to defend from a lot of different angles.
Oh, they're going to go for the force right now. This is cool. Krims working with his teammate, and there you go. He gets rewarded with the headshot on Apex. That clears out Pit. Now there's 2 members left here alive on this site, and before I can finish the sentence, they're both dead. Fnatic just walk right back into their own house and just kick out LDLC, the interlopers.
That was a really, really solid, retake. There's no other word for it. I'm a bit surprised that the guy from LDLC and Pit wasn't able to take out Olafmeister. But I guess he was held busy, or kept busy by Krims.
I think it was like Olafmeister chucks the incendiary in there. That forces Apex around. And then Krims was already pre-aiming on that little gap between the truck and the wall. So as soon as Apex shows himself, Krims puts one through the dome. Now, that was really nicely done there by Fnatic. Just thorough play. And that's actually putting LDLC in a bit of a tight spot here going into the 15th round, because they don't have a whole lot of nades to work with at this point.
Yeah, and it's not really a good sign for them, the fact that they actually managed to opt for the bomb site where Fnatic was not overloading. They were only 2 players on that beat, not a bomb site, and they still weren't able to close out the round, even if they got into proper afterplant positions.
And look at this cheeky play coming out. JW pop flashing into the apartments, Pronax peeking out to take down Apex. I mean, Fnatic are making it look easy right now to defend. They did lose Flusher but still have a lot of the two people waiting here, and Pronax is being aggressive at a time where they're definitely not expecting it. This is some very smart play from Pronax. He's going to be walking out all the way, and as long as he gets a kill here, he should be just fine. Happy waiting right at the edge of that smoke, and he's going to be walking right into Pronax, who's looking the wrong way and actually goes down. So for all the praise I gave him, they still give up the A bombsite.
You cursed him, Anders, you cursed him. I know you didn't mean it, but it happened.
No, I'm so sorry.
And this is, well, now actually we have to see that same kind of retake from Fnatic, except they're a man down in this position. Krims taking a peek towards short. There's a man waiting in boiler, though. We'll see if Krims is thorough and actually checks it. He's already in a duel, however, with the man holding the corner.
Yeah, it does check. Happy takes him down, takes Kaylee down. We are back into a 2-on-2. This is not done yet. Olofmeister goes, and now it's all on Krims. He's going to have to get a quad kill to try and win this round, and all they have to do is hide. They don't have to challenge him. They will, and they do take him down. So 10-5 for the first half. I think if you consider what you said earlier, Vendetta, that a lot of these rounds for LDLC have been them just landing some really lucky timings, I think they should be pretty happy with the result, actually.
Oh, yeah. I think so as well. Obviously, they're not going to be happy about losing the Ecos after winning the pistol, but yeah, I think they have to be content with five rounds at this point, especially given how well Fnatic have been playing on the CT side. But now, obviously, it remains to see if Fnatic are able to transfer that play over to the T side, which is, I guess, is one of the harder sides for a fairly new team. Even though everyone knows the map pretty well, it's you have to be pretty good at executing to get rounds versus a team like LDLC.
So for the upcoming pistol round, I mean, we saw Fnatic go with a crazy round that involved Pronax being the sole guy at the A-bomb site, and then four people from the B-bomb, or at the B-bomb site. Do you think LDLC is just going to go for a very standard setup? You know, 2A, 3B, or 3A, 2B, whatever you want.
Yeah, I guess it comes down to whether or not they've practiced a lot versus Fnatic since the lineup changes, and they have some sort of inkling as to what they're going to do. If they haven't, I think we would see a fairly standard setup, but seems like they're going four people towards the bomb site.
So they're doing a reverse Fnatic. Is that what we're seeing? They're leaving Kaylee alone. He has to get some great shots. Oh, a Molotov, but that's not going to stop them. They keep charging through, and that's a very smart play. They realize he is alone, and he's going to go down. Now, coming up from behind is one person. That was Apex. He goes down, gets caught down here by Flusher, and this is just such brilliant play from Fnatic.
And Flusher is still waiting there in the wings. He's gonna have a chance to run into Happy here. Happy needs to get this kill immediately. The duel has begun, and they're standing point blank. And it's gonna be Happy coming out on top, but he's lost his teammate in the meantime. It's 1-on-4. Happy, he has to win this. He has to pull a Krims.
Yeah, but they are not gonna wait for it. They could have even knifed him if they wanted to. I think that was just out of respect that they didn't. No idea how Flusher actually didn't just get the kill initially. I think that was just, you know, the curse of putting on burst fire, basically. That never works. But still, it's a very good round for Fnatic, and the instant decision to run through the Molotov. I think I've, just to credit myself a little bit, I've said this a number of times. Molotovs, they work really a lot better in rifle rounds, where people are a lot more hesitant to lose HP. But in pistol rounds, I've seen this so often, people do just tend to charge right through them.
I'm actually surprised they opted to go for a Molotov on the CT pistol, because normally you'd see most teams pick up Glock armor, and the Molotov doesn't do nearly as much damage versus armor as it does when someone doesn't have it, for obvious reasons. But yeah, I think that was a bit of a weird choice, because that Molotov basically tickles all the Fnatic members as they run past it.
Yeah, it doesn't work that well. It doesn't work that well, at least not in that position. It could be on other spots, it could be used a little bit better than we saw it here. Now they've left Maniac alone, and he has a P250 and still 50 seconds on the clock, but eventually Fnatic are going to come for, well, I was going to say the B bomb site, but Pronax has somehow figured out that A is better, and I absolutely have no idea how.
Did you see that double take from Olofmeister right there?
No.
Where Apex is pushing down second mid, Olofmeister just goes like casually walking by the door. They kind of look at each other for a second, and then Olofmeister's like, wait, what?
Oh, Uzi, those were some sick shots. C-set 75. Happy could take down Krims. This is absolutely brilliant. Now, let's see. The bomb is going to go down, and I think Kaylee's still pretty far away, but if they can just get that hit on Krims, they might be able to do this.
Well, let's see how things go here. They're actually going to split everything up as well. Both members going through short instead for LDLC, so they're deciding to gang up together. Good call here. JW's got full HP, though, and he already picks off Kaylee to start.
And Happy has 9 bullets left. Oh, he gets the one. He has a Khalil. He's not going to use it. He's running in. Oh, he gets it. The double kill. And Happy, they are going to win.
Think he has it.
No.
No, he doesn't have the time.
No.
Kaboom.
Oh, what a tragedy, because that was a round that LDLC definitely needed to win. If you just look at the round distribution at this point, 12-5, more than doubling the round score right now is Fnatic, and that's heartbreaking. I thought maybe he just had it.
Yeah, but you could tell that they were extremely pressed for time, which is why they opted to go both people around quad instead of trying to sandwich the guys on site, because with that smoke down, there's no real safe way to push in towards that bomb site for LDLC, so they opted to go around. And yeah, they were always going to have a rough time actually defusing that bomb. But still, they do wipe out all 5 Fnatic members, so at least that's something. You can see Pronex is wrecking the Galil instead of an AK, so they have done some damage to their economy, but I think they need one more round like that.
Oh, and Happy's trying to give them one. A great grenade and then a follow-up with the CZ 75 to take down Flusher. Things are looking very good. LDLC are not quite ready to exit this game yet. Pronax takes a lot of damage, but he does get the kill in return. But Fnatic are very much softened up at the moment.
Yeah, exactly. Uzi still manages to do quite a bit of damage to Pronax, but it looks like Fnatic, they're not going to back off of this site. They've made up their minds. This is theirs! There's the first kill onto Uzi. Olafmeister clearing everything. But is Kaylee actually going to try and sneak through the smoke? He did, but Pronax caught him.
Krim's the only one on 100% HP, but everyone else is quite low on Fnatic, but it doesn't matter any longer. Apex just doesn't have the weaponry to deal with this, and Olafmeister will take him down, so it's close, but it's not quite there, and that leaves us at 13-5 now that LDLC can finally buy.
Yeah, and once again, this is a bit of a now or never moment for LDLC. They were in a pretty similar situation versus Hellraisers, and they weren't able to do it that time. Maybe they've figured it out by now.
Let's see. I mean, you've already got the nades going down. They're pretty standard right now. Fnatic just working their way up second mid, getting close to mid. Wondering if perhaps they were trying to... they weren't sure if Kaylee would have that AWP or not. Perhaps not wanting to give him the opportunity to take a shot down mid like that. But JW is still around. And he's looking towards Boiler, so I mean... Fnatic, they're up close and personal, but LDLC, they don't want any of it. They want dinner first.
Yeah, they are holding pretty passively, and that could be a bit of an issue if Fnatic get the first pick off here. They're not going to have a lot of information to go by, LDLC. They're just going to lose a guy and then be no wiser at all. Still 55 seconds left, and what are Fnatic going to do once they get going here? I mean, it's looking like an A push with the bomb all the way over here, but they still have time to switch it up.
Yeah, I think that right now they're just content in baiting out nades from LDLC, and they've done a pretty good job of it so far. Is the Uzi already down to just one flash? Same with Maniac and Apex. And Happy, actually. So the only one with any real grenade artillery is Kaylee.
Oh, when are they going to push? Now it's on. 30 seconds left. They're going to be throwing in the smokes. And Maniac up on the balcony here is already flashed. He's turning around, just making sure he doesn't get double flashed at the very least. But they are pushing in, and backup needs to come quickly. There's Apex and Maniac picking up some good kills. JW actually all the way up on the balcony. He's going to go down eventually. But it's still a 2-on-3. And Pronax trying to see if he can clear out Maniac. And he will do it. But just as he does, they lose the round. And the backup has arrived from Uzi and Happy. So 13-6.
Yeah, I think the execution for Fnatic was a tiny bit too slow right there, because LDLC, again, as versus Hellraisers, their rotation was really slow. Fnatic already had 4 people up in quad, and at the same time, LDLC still had 2 players over at the B-bomb site. So if Fnatic are able to push through everything just a tiny bit faster, I think they might be able to at least get the bomb plant down.
What do you think 30 seconds is enough for that kind of play? Because that seems to be, like, they let, like, Fnatic started the push at 30. So it's like, that doesn't leave you a whole lot of wiggle room if things go south or if you get bogged down, like a good flash, anything like that. And yeah, LDLC, they can hold.
I actually think that smoke from Maniac just saved Olafmeister, because he was walking up and Apex was aiming right at him, so... I think that could have been an easy headshot for Apex. A little bit unfortunate, and even more unfortunate was the fact that Kaylee got... caught while he was just sort of rotating towards the middle, so another good timing coming out from Fnatic, and this round is shaping up pretty well in their favor at the moment, except that kill hat coming in on Krims, who's the top fragger. That's not good.
It's not good at all, and Pronix is down to 5 HP, and I don't like what I'm seeing right now, and that's Happy rotating over towards the B bomb site. this could spell trouble for Fnatic, because it seems like Flesh is just going in towards the B bomb site to sell the fake here.
They're going for
looks like he's able to as well, because Happy's committed to the B bomb site right now.
Oh, Apex does a fine job defending. A quick double kill and then a triple, making it a quad in total. Very nicely done here from LDLC's captain, and it's going to be 7-13. I mean, we're 21 rounds into the game, but it feels like a little bit that Fnatic are running out of steam, and they're suddenly running out of money.
Yeah, that's the main concern here, I think, for Fnatic at this point. They've been forced to eco. So no plant that round. They're just broke at this point. Not even anywhere near the point where, like, Hellraisers, you know, they would buy. What a shot from Kaylee, though. Yeah. That was fantastic. Right mid, hardly even stopped, and picks JW out of the air, no less. Okay. But, yeah, this is, like, they have $2,000. They can't even pull, like, a Hellraisers buy and go for, like, Galil armor.
That was a decent shot. I do those all the time.
Ain't no thing.
No Ain't problem. No thing, but a chicken wing.
Well, yeah, pretty quick and easy round for LDLC. And finally, Fnatic can buy up again. So I think a lot of this is going to come down to... I think LDLC still have to play pretty much close to perfect to win this game, because Fnatic are getting into that room where they can more or less force up whenever they want to.
What are they going to do? Fnatic pushing pretty aggressively over by Banana, and actually Uzi's going to hear them coming and just falls back safely, which is a very good idea. Are they going to try and flash out? Oh, Uzi, he peeks before the flash happens, so I have no idea what's going on. That leaves Happy alone, and a big screw-up here from LDLC. A lot hinges on this. Happy has to stay alive for a very long time. He's going to get smoked off, and he goes down, and that might just be the end.
Very nice work. Flush it through the smoke, just putting shots into CT. Apex happens to cross one. But that was just very clean work there from Fnatic as well, especially when they decided to peek at Coils to take that fight. Looking towards Flowers and pick off the man there. I believe it was Happy. They peaked together, right? Wasn't one of them going in one after the other, you know, like just, oh, I'm going to YOLO rush him down. No, Fnatic, they paused, Flusha throws the smoke, and then they both peak exactly at the same time. So just really clean work by Fnatic throughout this entire map.
Yeah.
It's
like the worst case scenario in that situation is that they get a trade. And that's exactly like they're perfectly happy with that in that situation.
Happened is that Happy and Uzi had a really good recipe to defend this bomb site, but when you are following a recipe, it's pretty important that you take, you know, step one first and then step two second, because what step they just did was basically they just said, oh, it says eggs in the recipe, we'll just like throw eggs, don't break them first, just right into the dough, no question about it. Happy had a flashbang, he was like probably saying to Uzi, I'm gonna throw this flashbang and then you peek, and Uzi was like, no, I'm just gonna peek right now and you can throw the flash later. And that just didn't work out at all.
That
now,
flash wouldn't have been effective anyway, so that's the problem. JW, like, that's like the nine, like the one times out of like 50 that JW is going to be past the angle actually looking towards sight for Kaylee. Like, Kaylee's expecting to have to run around the angle there. That's what went south.
Either way, the idea of peeking before the flash is still completely insane, basically. Good defense from Maniac here is going to try and bring it back. Crims does go. Actually, two headshots coming in there, and he controls the bomb as well. Maniac runs down and very nearly gets another kill in, but still leaves JW alone. And he's going to have to go for an ace here, and he actually has the time for it.
He has a minute on the clock. This is a lifetime right now for JW. And he even goes for an op?
Hell
Did he really
yes.
just swap out for an AWP in a 1v2? Only JW.
It's a manly option, but... I guess he might want to try to find that first frag and make it a 1v1 and then swap back to the Colt. But it seems like LDLC are playing this as safe as humanly possible. They're just spreading themselves out, and
it's like a patience game at this point.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I'm not a big fan of Happy's position though. Like, he could get caught out here.
Yeah, but it seems like actually he's gonna be waiting just long enough, and eventually JW will have to make some noise. Did he make some noise jumping? Happy's really patient. 10 seconds left, and JW is going to get in and get the bomb down, but I don't think he can actually get out of here. Oh, actually, Happy gets a shot right through. That's a very narrow angle, but it works out just fine. So there it is, 14-9. That's now how many rounds in a row for LDLC?
One, because
before that, sorry. How many rounds did they win before that?
It was 13-5, I want to say.
Yeah, so they
something
got,
like that.
Yeah, so they got four rounds in a row or something like that.
Yeah, they've definitely started the climb, for sure.
Yeah, my graph doesn't work, so I can't even tell. Nothing works. My scoreboard doesn't work either.
The wheel of technology.
Oh my god! Oh, grenade up in the apartments. Not really going to do that much damage, and it's going to be Apex picking up a kill, but this rush is working out great for Fnatic. Should be able to get the bomb down from Olaf Meister. He's inside the site just waiting, and Katie's a little bit hesitant, so that'll give the Swedish team some money to work with. But actually winning the 1-on-3 is quite a different matter altogether, and they're just going to be charging him down. No issue at all, and LDLC make it to 10-14.
Still pretty good eco from Fnatic. Got the plant, got two frags. So... yeah, they need to get something... they need to get something going. I mean, yeah, sure, they've gotten around here and there, but... feels like LDLC are getting into their own right now.
They're remembering what it's like playing this game.
Yeah, that vacation dust is finally starting to disappear.
Hell, I think, well, actually Apex not having that big of a performance this game. But if Apex was actually doing, you know, up top fragging again, I would have been like, well, Apex needs to take more vacation, clearly.
A little bit more.
Yeah. It's actually pretty crazy if you look at the difference in deaths between Apex and Happy. Apex has gone down 22 rounds and Happy only 14, and that's pretty impressive if you're down 14 to 10 at this point.
It's true. Pretty means Happy's been in the B-bomb side a lot and just, you know, shown up to the party maybe a little bit late.
Doing that stat padding?
All right. Stats are all that matter, right?
That smoke, no, it's not for Boiler Room. So if they peek here, look at how patient JW is. He just wants one guy to poke out and maybe see if he can get the pick off. He's patiently waiting 35 seconds. I mean, the whole of Fnatic just, you know, ready to explode as soon as JW does anything. But they decide there's no more time to wait. They are going to have to go for it. It will be an A push. And again, they leave Flusher over the B bomb side just to be a distraction. Maniac doing good damage early on and ready for someone to come out of the apartments. But a lot of flashes rain in. Happy picking up the first kill over at the B bomb site. And now the rush is on.
Oh, they're so crucial to leave it down to 10 seconds and for them to get all three kills to clear up the A site. Fnatic with an excellent take, and now it's just the B defense rotating over, and LDLC, there's no saving. Now they have to go for this.
Yeah, they do, but how do you retake this bomb site with, you know, one guy on half HP and no grenades at all? They can't even smoke anything out or anything. Now Happy alone, and Crims just shoots right through the smoke, and it will be 15 to 10 match and map point for the newly forged Fnatic team. And, you know, one of the new players here, Crims, top fragging with 27 kills. It's not like Olaf Meister's far behind on 19.
Crims is interested in sharing.
Yeah, but there we saw pretty much the same setup that Fnatic did in the previous A take, only they executed faster. And they pretty much just wiped out the entire LDLC team. That was the only change they needed, actually, just attacking quicker.
Well, the rotation has to come out here quickly. We already have Kaylee, who's going to be supporting from CT, but that smoke is going to go down to block off that that CT alley. Not going to be able to see in here. JW is already looking towards the new boxes. Needs to find this last man. Happy is back here with 12 HP.
Yeah, they've double naded him down. Katie very nearly shot Happy, I think, just a little bit too confused then. And then the grenades rain in. It's 3-4 right now. The bomb is down. JW picks up yet another kill. And now Apex going to be charging in. He's not going to check Cronax. And he goes down. So Katie is alone in a 1-on-4, and this looks like victory for Fnatic. It will be victory for Fnatic. Crims with the last headshot seems like a very